So we are working on a layered approach. So what I told you that in a layered approach we have some benefits also, so we have some drawbacks also. So let's see how these things works in layered approach. System is not working properly. Okay, so this approach allow you each layer to be developed and debugged independently. Layered approach allow each layer to be developed and debugged independently with the assumption that all lower layers have already been debugged and are trusted to deliver proper services. Now, what do you understand by these layers are properly debugged and trusted? Means dean, head of department, vice chancellor, these are the first having some specific services to provide you each specific functionality they are having. Special powers they are having in hand, so they are can be trusted, so that they are having so that power in their hand, so that they can solve your problem. So this approach allows each layer to be developed and debugged independently with the assumption that all lower layers have already been debugged and trusted to deliver proper services. Now, layered approaches can also be less efficient, as I told you that there is a much processing in each layer. That is why layered approach can also be less efficient, because as a request for a service from higher layer has to filter through all lower layers before it reaches the hardware, possibly with significant processing at each step. Who is at the top of the hierarchy? Who is at the top of the higher level? This is the normal end user who wants to interact with the hardware, and in real world, a student wants to interact with the vice chancellor, but he has to follow the hierarchy. He has to follow the each and every layer to interact with the hardware. That is why it may be in some scenarios it is less efficient. So layered approach can also be less efficient, as a request for service from higher layer has to filter through all lower layers before it reaches the hardware, possibly with significant processing at each step. So this is a general diagram of a layered operating system. Layer N, that is the user interface on top of a user interface, is there, and that layer N wants to interact with the layer zero hardware. But in between, there are a number of layers. You can think of that there is an application program, there are some system programs, there are some drivers, and each and every layer is having some specific functionality to provide to the user. So this is how a layered operating system design is worked. Now we are having microkernels. How microkernels work, let's see. Basic idea behind microkernel is to remove all non-essential services from the kernel and implement them as system applications instead, thereby making the kernel as small and efficient as possible. What we have in microkernel, there is a kernel and there is a microkernel. Now we are having a smaller version of kernel, which is called microkernel. And why we have designed microkernel? We have designed microkernel just to make essential services into the microkernel itself, and all the non-essential services can be solved using the system applications. So the basic idea behind microkernel is to remove all non-essential services from the kernel and implement them as system applications instead, thereby making the kernel as small and efficient as possible. So have an analogy with, again, the dean faculty, that all essential services like your issues related with your results and fees can be solved and tackled by the dean, and all the non-essential services like some signing some documents, verifying your credentials, can be he provided the authority to the office superintendent that can solve all other queries of the students. So you can think of office superintendent as a system application, and microkernel can taken care only your essential services, by which what we are doing, we are securing the kernel, microkernel in this case, with some additional outsider threads and making it more efficient so that it can solve less number of problems, so that it can have a less turnaround time to solve the problem, because less number of students are coming to solving their problem for a specific purpose only, and all other non-essential services can be solved by the office superintendent itself. Now, most microkernels provide basic process management, memory management, and message passing only, means only essential services are in the microkernel, like process management, memory management, and message passing between other services, and not much more. So what we have done, we have truncated the power and functionality of a kernel. We have given only main activities, main functionality like process management and memory management and message passing between other services, and all other services are given as a system applications to the user. In this way, security and protection can be enhanced, as most services are performed in user mode but not in kernel mode. So this is the purpose of this microkernel, to enhance the security and protection of the system. Can be enhanced as most services are performed in user mode but not in kernel mode. So system expansion can also be easier. In case of microkernel, system expansion can also be easier. Why system expansion can be easier? Because only essential things are in kernel. If you want to add one more functionality to your system, you can append that functionality as a system application only. You don't need to touch the kernel. So what it is written here, system expansion can also be easier because it only involves adding more system application, not rebuilding a new kernel. Mac was the first and most widely known microkernel and now forms a major component of Mac operating system. Another microkernel example is QNX, a real-time operating system for embedded systems. So these are some example of microkernels like Mac, QNX. Now, here is an architecture of a typical microkernel. As you can see that in kernel mode, microkernel solving only particular problems like inter-process communication, memory management, CPU scheduling. And all other services like application program, file system, device drivers that can be put out of the kernel, and the application program, file system can communicate bi-directionally with the help of message passing. Here, file system and device driver can communicate with the help of message driver. Means a file system needs some services of application program, then they can communicate directly with the help of inter-process communication service of the microkernel. But all these services are explicitly provided, not in the microkernel itself. So here you can see that application program, file system, and device driver are in user mode now. Previously, these all things are taken care by the kernel only, but in microkernel flavor, only essential things in microkernel like inter-process communication, memory management, and CPU scheduling. So these are things in the kernel mode. And now that kernel microkernel can interact with the hardware and provide the services to the user as intended. So this is the typical architecture of a microkernel. As you can see that microkernel is having inter-process communication, memory management, and CPU scheduling in the kernel mode. So let's have another type of operating system structure that is called modules. Can understand by modules? Modern operating system development is object-oriented. What is the meaning of object-oriented? Means each and every functionality can be provided as a separate module. So in that case, modern operating system development is object-oriented with relatively a small core kernel and set of modules which can be linked in a dynamically. Here you can think of a set of modules as a separate functionality providers that can be added as a system programs, and they can have their own functionality as a module. So modern operating system is object-oriented. Let's see. Modules are similar to layers in that each subsystem has clearly defined tasks and interfaces, but any module is free to contact any other module, eliminating the problems of going through multiple intermediary layers. As you can see that it is similar to layered operating system structure, but what happens here, microkernel also for inter-process communication, you have to go through to the kernel mode only. But here in modules, there is no need of that kernel mode inter-process communication. Any module is free to contact any other module directly. So in this way, we are also making the microkernel more light so that All these services can be explicitly solved by the modules only. The kernel is relatively small in this architecture. Similar to microkernels, but the kernel does not have to implement message passing. As you can see, that inter-process communication and message passing has been implemented directly into the by the modules directly. So these services can be explicitly removed from the kernel. So the kernel is relatively small in this architecture. Why we are making kernel small? Just to make it more efficient, so that it can focus on more essential things of users and provide less turnaround time to solve their problem. Okay, so let's see. Here is a simple diagram of this module structure of an operating system. Here is a core Solaris kernel. We are having scheduling classes module, file system module, loadable system calls module, executable formats module, streams module, miscellaneous modules, device and bus drivers modules. All these modules can directly communicate to each other. And this core Solaris is an operating system example for you that is designed as per the module of structure of operating system. Here core Solaris kernel is in between, and all these modules are connected through each other. So we are having this type of diagram for these loadable modules. And one thing that in examination, these diagrams are marks booster for you. So these diagrams are very essential to include in your answer questions. So please prepare all these diagrams very well. It will help to boost your marks. Now, next to what we have some hybrid system are also there. And what are hybrid systems are doing, like Mac operating system is there, iOS and Android. These hybrid system means they are using multiple type of architecture in one, like they have some flavor of microkernel, they are having some flavor of module operating system, and they are having some flavor of layered operating system. So these hybrid systems are operating system that are Mac operating system, iOS and Android. So these are the different type of structure of operating system, and we are having some questions on that, like what do you mean by kernel, what is kernel, describe various operations performed by kernel, what is the main advantage of the layered approach to system design, what are the disadvantages of the layered approach. This question can be reframed for like microkernel also. What is the main advantage of the microkernel structure of operating system, what are its disadvantages? These kinds of things can be taken care. It means these kind of questions can be framed just like layered approach question is framed. And write about monolithic kernel, layered and microkernel structures of operating system. Explain briefly layered operating system with neat sketch. So today's topic was the structure of operating system. We have seen some general structure of operating system. Now I am again revising the whole class once again so that you can clear with these things right now. Like first one was simple structure in which each and every application program can directly access to the underlying hardware. Here is an example of MS-DOS layer structure where application program, resident system programs, MS-DOS device drivers, they are directly interacting with the ROM BIOS device driver, means they are directly interacting with the hardware. So this is a simple structure. Now in traditional Unix system structure, what is happening that we are having all the essential and non-essential functions of an operating system in one big layer, which is can be think of as a kernel of the operating system, and all other things are in one big block only, like signal terminals handling character input output system, terminal drivers, file system, swapping block input output system, disk and tape driver, CPU scheduling, page replacement, demand paging, virtual memory. Means memory management, process management, input output devices management, peripheral devices management, in security, auditing, all these things are one big layer. So this can be think of a simple layered approach that all each and every application program, system programs can directly interact with the hardware only. Then we go on for layered approach where we have seen some hierarchy out there, and each and every layer having some specific purpose, specific functionality, and having some specific power to solve the problems of an end user. And we can have also seen that drawback of layered operating system is it is less efficient also, because each and every layer may involve a significant processing to solve a particular problem. And in layered operating system, here is a simple diagram, like we are having layer N user interface, multiple layer user is at the layer N, and layer zero we are having a hardware. Now in microkernel, what is the idea of microkernel? The basic idea behind microkernel is to remove all non-essential services from the kernel and implement them as system applications instead. Means all the essential services only designed and solved by the microkernel, and all the non-essential services are taken care by the system application. What are the system application? We will study in the next class how system applications are designed and how they help a kernel to solve those problems. Most microkernels provide basic process management, memory management, and message passing only, and in this way they can help security and protection of the operating system. And there is another benefit of using microkernel is that we can add more functionality in very easy manner, because we don't need to rebuild the kernel from the scratch. We can add those functionality as a separate system applications only. Mac was the first and most widely known microkernel. Then we have QNX, a real-time operating system. Here is a diagram of a typical microkernel. As you can see, in user mode, we have thrown the application program, file system, and device driver. And in kernel mode, we are having inter-process communication, memory management, CPU scheduling. And these user mode application programs can interact through the message passing with the help of microkernel only. And then microkernel can interact with the hardware to solve the problems. Now we in the modern time we are having modules. Modern operating system development is object oriented. We are having a relatively small core kernel and set of modules that can link dynamically, and any module is free to contact any other module, so that microkernel don't need to implement the message passing, as each and every module can interact each other directly. Here is a simple diagram of a Solaris operating system, which is based on module structure of operating system. Here you can see a general glimpse of different modules, like scheduling classes, file system, loadable system class, executable format, streams modules, miscellaneous modules, device and bus drivers. So these are the different modules, and they are having some specific functionality to provide the end user, and they can directly interact with. And we are having some hybrid system also, Mac OS, iOS, and Android. Tomorrow is Independence Day, so there will be no class. So we will meet in next week with system applications, and then our half unit has been completed. After completing the system programs, then we will go for process management. Now in process management, we really started the operating system services. So we are stopping here. Today's class, we will meet in after that. Okay, so today we have discussed different type of operating system, different type of structure of operating system. I will upload today's lecture note in the Google Classroom. You can download your lecture notes from there. And please inform other students of your class that I can see only 40 students are attending the classes. What about other students? They can lag and behind you. So please contact them so that at least they are not able to have live classes. Then they can go for some Google Classroom stuff. They can download study material, and please help out those your classmates. They are your friends, so help them out. Okay, beta. Thank you, class. See you next week. Happy Independence Day. Bye-bye.